First, please do subscribe to this channel. The China-Tibet Railway is also called the Xining-Lhasa Railway, which names the start and destination cities. It's also called the Qinghai-Tibet Railway, which names the start and destination provinces. In this video, I'll refer to it as the Xining-Lhasa Railway. There is no doubt that this railway line is a great engineering feat, and I will go into a little bit more detail about this later. But first, a little reminder of an earlier video I had made, which you can see on this channel. The blue lines represent the highways running from the city of Chengdu in eastern China to Lhasa. The white line represents the railway line starting from the town of Xining in the Qinghai province, way, way up north of the place where the highway already existed. One might wonder, why did the Chinese not build a shorter train route to Lhasa parallel to the existing highways? The answer, like much else that is related to Tibet, lies in geography. Here is a virtual flyby along the existing highway. It passes through high mountains and deep valleys with many sharp bends. Railway lines cannot have sharp bends like roads, and building a railway line through this would be much more difficult than bypassing the mountain range from the north and entering Tibet from the north in a railway line that heads almost straight down south from there. This virtual flypast shows the terrain in Tibet, which appears ideal for a railway line, flat and suitable for long, straight stretches of track. But things are not that simple, and the reasons are permafrost and high altitude leading to low oxygen levels. This image is a graphic illustration of permafrost in Tibet. Permafrost is, as the name suggests, permanent frost, or permanently frozen ground. Wet soil is frozen into a rock-hard layer called permafrost. About 70% of Tibet is permafrost. About 500 kilometers of the Xining-Lhasa track are built on permafrost. But Tibet's permafrost is unstable or fragile. For permafrost to be frozen throughout the year, temperatures must never rise above 0 degrees centigrade. This is true of parts of Alaska and Siberia. But in the summer in Tibet, the temperature rises to 1 to 2 degrees centigrade and the upper layers of soil become wet and slushy, so any structure built on this layer will collapse. For this reason, Chinese engineers have used many methods to ensure that the ground beneath the railway track remains frozen. The simplest method is to have a layer of porous rocks above the frozen soil. In this method, heat from above does not reach the frozen ground because cold air enters the gaps in the rock, which then stays cold. In other areas, like river beds, where rails cannot be laid directly, deep piles or pillars are driven into the frozen ground so that the heat from the trains on the rails does not affect the ground, which stays frozen. In other areas, they've used pipes filled with liquid ammonia sunk into the permafrost. If the ice starts melting, the ammonia evaporates and freezes the ice again, while the ammonia gas rises up to the part of the pipe that is above the ground and gets cooled by the cold air in Tibet. With all this, there is still no guarantee that the railway track will be stable. So the Chinese have placed soil temperature monitors every 100 meters in the permafrost area, and the readings are monitored in a laboratory in Golmud. Even so, there has to be constant track monitoring and maintenance every day to avoid the track sinking, leading to a train accident. So what does all this information mean? First, it must be noted that the single line from Xining to Lhasa is a choke point of sorts. All passengers going by train from Beijing, Shanghai, Chengdu and other cities must all congregate on Xining to get on the Lhasa track. Because the track on permafrost is unstable and requires a lot of maintenance, the number of trains is limited. There are only 4 to 5 passenger trains per day running in both directions on the Xining-Lhasa Railway. There are some freight trains also, and it has been suggested that the maximum number of trains allowable per day on this track is 10 trains in each direction. Seemingly in support of this, it appears that the Chinese do not increase the number of trains in the holiday season when there is an increased rush. In fact, they say just book your tickets in advance. So there are no special holiday trains, suggesting that an increase in the number of trains is either not possible or not easy to implement. This information is of some strategic interest regarding the number of trains Beijing can use to transport war material in case of conflict. Hundreds of trains will be required to transport the material required for several army divisions, subject to the limit of about 10 trains a day. Looks like a lot of the supplies will have to come by road. This graph shows the elevation or altitude of the track from Xining to Lhasa. The train, in 21 hours, must climb up to heights of over 5 kilometers and then come down to Lhasa at about 3.5 kilometers high. That means that passengers can develop altitude sickness in the train itself. For this reason, the train has oxygen-enriched air that keeps the pressure at Lhasa pressure. Still, this can cause problems, so emergency oxygen is available on trains. It takes several days for people to get acclimatized to the rare air of Lhasa. So if large numbers of troops are transported, they must halt at Lhasa for acclimatization. Finally, here is a short virtual tour of the Xining-Lhasa rail route. Xining is the source. Golmud is a military town and is virtually out of bounds for foreigners. As the train heads into Tibet, Tangula is the highest railway station. Amdo is a large maintenance center. The permafrost starts south of Amdo. As the train approaches Lhasa, the terrain becomes mountainous, and there are multiple bridges on the track, all within reach of the Indian Air Force. Thanks for watching, if you got so far.